Why don't we just stream the data from the aircraft black boxes straight down to a server on the ground? This is a question that comes up almost every time there's been a major accident out there. People are asking, quite rightfully so, with all of the technology that we have available today, why doesn't the aircraft just stream all of the data in real time up to the cloud or to a server on the ground so that in case of a horrible accident, we can immediately access it and find out what has happened? Well, today we're going to be discussing what is happening in the industry around this, and it turns out that it's more complicated than you might think, so stay tuned. The recent tragic loss of a Boeing 737-800 in China, where it crashed almost vertically into a hillside, is yet another example of where reading the black boxes, the cockpit voice recorder and the flight data recorder, has proven difficult. In this case, it wasn't really a problem to actually find the black boxes, but the problem presented itself in the fact that one of the black boxes, the cockpit voice recorder, was severely damaged, and we still don't know whether or not they are going to be able to capture or reread all of the data that was stored on it. But usually the question about having a real-time communication between aircraft and the ground comes up in cases where the black boxes have been really hard to find. A good example was the tragic crash of Air France flight 447, where it took several months before they could actually locate the aircraft and the black boxes. And of course, the horrible story about the Malaysian Airlines flight MH370, in which case we still haven't found neither the aircraft nor the black boxes, which means that we don't really know what happened. In both those cases, the wait and the uncertainty has been unbearable for the relatives and friends of the people who disappeared. And also, it has been a tragic loss of information for us in the aviation industry, where we could have learned about what had happened so that we can prevent it from happening again. And these two examples serve as probably the best reasons why we should try to look for a way to transmit data from the aircraft in real time down to the ground in one way or another. So would it be technically possible to do this? Well, the answer to that is yes, but as always, there is more to the story than meets the eye. And it turns out that there are some really good reasons why we have those black boxes still physically attached to the aircraft. So let's start with a little bit of a history lesson here. Where the black boxes came from, why they're called black boxes, what they can and cannot do, and why they're so important in their current role. Like I mentioned before, there are normally two devices that are referred to as the black boxes. It's the cockpit voice recorder that takes up the voices from the pilots, from the ambient, and I'll get more into that later on. And it's the flight data recorder that takes up all of the parameters from the technical systems aboard the aircraft, like engines, flap positions, and so on. On some of the more modern aircraft, these have actually been combined into one unit called the CVDR, which is the cockpit voice and data recorder. There's still some debate about where the first black boxes were actually installed. There are records showing that there were some type of black boxes being used in the United States, in France, in the United Kingdom, in Finland and in Australia, to name a few. But what we do know is that the first type of black boxes were not used in commercial aircraft. They were used in test aircraft, and normally they only carried a single type of medium, for example, film. The use of photographic film inside some of these early recording devices was probably one of the reasons they were referred to as black boxes in the first case, because they would have had to be painted black in order to keep as much light as possible out of the box to protect the sensitive film inside. But then, during the Second World War, most of the navigational equipment and radio boxes were painted black by default, so it's not a strange thing if this new added technical equipment was fitted into boxes that were also painted black. So it is possible that because of these reasons, the very first time that the world press got into contact with one of these devices, they saw that it was black, they named it a black box, and that name has just stuck with us from that time. What we do know though is that when it became time for these recording devices to be fitted onto commercial aircraft, they were no longer black. They were painted in a very bright orange or sometimes yellow color, and the thought behind that was that in case of a crash, it would be very easy to identify these particular pieces from other aircraft parts on the crash site. These boxes have been built to be incredibly sturdy. They're built to withstand 3,400 Gs in 6.5 milliseconds, and that's the equivalent of decelerating an object down from 270 knots to zero in only 45 centimeters, which is incredible. They can also take really high temperatures, low temperatures, and they're able to be submerged under kilometers of water, taking the pressure that that means. The latest versions of these black boxes are also made with solid state memories, which means that they have almost no moving parts, making them even more durable. To even further increase the chance of these devices surviving a crash or accident, the aircraft manufacturers tend to fit them at the very back and the top of the aircraft. But in most cases, when there's been a serious accident or incident, we actually use a different device than the black boxes to download the data, something called a QAR, or a Quick Access Recorder. As the name suggests, the QAR is really quick to access, and that means that if there is a technical malfunction of the aircraft that we, the pilots, have reported to engineering, the engineering only really needs to access the QAR to get most or all of the data that they need to determine what the cause of the problem was. They will never access the black boxes. But that brings me to a really important point that I want to emphasize, and that is that in the vast majority of incidents or even accidents, it's not really a mystery where the aircraft is. The aircraft is right there at the gate. The engineering or the investigation team can readily access the recorders if they need to. And this actually brings me to the first argument against the need to have to stream the black box data to the ground or to the cloud. And that is how incredibly rare it is that we don't find these black boxes in case of an accident. The fact that you guys can probably name almost all of the instances where the black boxes have not been able to be recovered just shows how incredibly rare that is. The fact is that most accidents and incidents tend to happen during either the takeoff or the landing phase, which means that it's close to an airport and it would be reasonably easy to recover the black boxes and get their data. And in the few instances where that's not the case, like Air France 447 or MH370, there has been some significant improvements during the last few years to help us track aircraft in real time and avoid those type of mysteries from happening again. Do pilots need to be good at maths? Yes, yes they do. And this is a question that I'm getting surprisingly often from aspiring pilots and even members of the public like yourself. And this is why I am so happy to introduce today's sponsor, which is Wouldnt. Wouldnt is a problem-solving and really interactive platform with award-winning courses from teachers and professionals at places like MIT, Microsoft, and more. On Wouldnt, it is your natural curiosity that will drive you, not the threat of a test hanging over you. Whether you are into logic, classical mechanics, or maybe computer science, there's always something STEM-related in there for you. And with personalized training, Wouldnt has content for all skill levels and ages out there. I just wish that I would have known about Wouldnt when I was a student, but I'm really happy that I found them now. If you want to check this out absolutely for free, then go down and click on the link here in the description below, which is wouldnt.org/mentor now, and the first 200 that clicks on that link will also get a whopping 20% off the annual fee of Wouldnt. So go down and check it out. One of the new technologies that have popped up during the last few years is something called ADSB, or Automatic Dependence Surveillance Broadcast. ADSB is using already existing systems inside of the aircraft, like its GPS and its transponder, to transmit things like the aircraft position, its speed, its altitude, and a few other parameters. So it's not about sending out a massive amount of data from the aircraft, but it will follow where the aircraft is, and it will help find an aircraft that has suddenly disappeared, which you've probably seen numerous reports about during the accidents that have happened during the last few years. Each fitted aircraft is constantly sending this information out and is being picked up by ground-based ADSB stations. Those stations are actually technically quite simple, and you could probably make one yourself if you're a little bit technically inclined. And the data from those ADSB stations is what sites like FlightAware or FlightRadar24 is using to give that information freely to anyone out there, like yourself. This is a fantastic new technology, and it's obviously much cheaper than building a ground-based radar station, which has made it possible for smaller airports out there to be able to track movement around them, even without a proper radar. And it's also made it possible for smaller aircraft to keep track of each other in the airspace around them. So it's a great innovation, and in some cases, it has actually been more accurate than ground-based radar, where in some of the recent accidents that has happened, the ADSB data has been able to track the aircraft all the way down to an altitude as low as 3,000 feet, while conventional radar has actually lost the radar target as high up as 11,000 feet. The downside of ADSB is that up until recently it's been relying on these ground-based stations, which means that you can actually lose ADSB coverage over big oceans, for example, which is where, in the case of MH370, the problem actually occurred. But this has been changing recently, and that is because more and more ADS-B stations is actually being carried by satellites. And when you have ADS-B coverage by a satellite through the use of these new systems, for example, Starlink and other initiatives like that, then we will have truly global ADS-B coverage, which means that something like MH370 should not happen again. However, some of you might point out at this point that ADS-B still relies on the systems operating inside of the aircraft, as in the transponder having electrical power, for example, the GPS system working and so on. But in fact, so does the black boxes. Right? The black boxes also need electrical power. If the electrical power is being shut off in the aircraft, the black boxes will not function either. So yes, some of the aircraft systems still need to work properly in order for ADS-B tracking to work. And also, ADS-B is not built to be able to take the enormous volume of data that is being stored inside of the black boxes. And that's where we come to the next issue. This is where we have to start talking about data volume. Because the amount of data that would have to be transmitted via satellite link in order for a system that would replace the black boxes to work is quite significant, actually. The cockpit voice recorder, for example, records high-quality audio from several different channels, one for each pilot, and then an ambient channel inside of the cockpit, and also in some cases ambient noise from the front of the aircraft just behind the cockpit. The amount of audio that needs to be stored is a minimum of 2 hours, but in the future, it will probably be better to have even more than that. On top of that, the flight data recorder used to have to store only 33 different parameters, but now there's a minimum of 88 different parameters that needs to be stored going back at least 20 hours of flight. Because of that, the amount of data that would need to be stored and transmitted continuously over a typical long-haul flight would be in the region of about 20 gigabytes per flight. And that might not sound a lot to you, but the cost of having to transmit 20 gigabytes of data, high quality, without interruption, through satellites, would actually be very, very high. And if you start looking at a fleet that would maybe have hundreds of aircraft that would need to do this for each and every flight, the cost could quickly start spiraling out of control. It should be said here that the cost of this type of data transfer via satellite is steadily going down with the help of projects like Starlink and OneWeb, but it is still significant, and it's also going to be hard to motivate to the airlines why this would be a needed expense to have, given the high reliability and recovery rate of the existing black boxes. Now, there is another idea out there that might be both more realistic and more cost-effective, and it's actually already being used by quite a few companies. And this is the idea of the aircraft itself sending out a short burst of black box data in case it feels that something is not right. And in fact, most aircrafts are already monitoring this. They're checking that their flight is happening within certain parameters. And I've talked about this in a video I did over on the Mentor Pilot channel called The Cockpit Spy. You can check this out. And that's within the OFDM data program, so the Operational Flight Data Monitoring Program. If that system were to be used, in that case, the aircraft could feel itself when, for example, a rapid depressurization would happen, or an engine failure, or the aircraft would find itself in a very unusual attitude. And if that would happen, it would send out this short burst of all of the parameters that the flight data recorder and the cockpit voice recorder would have, covering maybe 45 seconds up to the event, or even up to 2 minutes that some companies are already doing. That could potentially prove invaluable for any investigation that might follow, and it would also be a system that potentially even the pilots could trigger themselves. If they feel that something is off, they could hit a button and that short burst of data would then be sent. And obviously the benefit of this would be that rather than the aircraft sending out 20 gigabytes of data that would never be used by anyone, this could potentially just be data sent out when it is actually needed, and it could form a really, really good tool. Another idea that was actually looked at very seriously back in the 1990s and the beginning of 2000s was the idea of an ejectable black box. This would be a black box clone identical to the ones that were fitted permanently to the aircraft that, in the case of one of these parameters being exceeded, like the ones that I've just talked about, it could be ejected from a non-pressurized part of the aircraft. It would then be fitted with a small parachute and flotation devices and a radio beacon, so it would be easy to find and serve the same kind of purpose as the data burst idea would. But obviously this idea came up back when the thought of having the ability to transmit this amount of data in such a short time was inconceivable. Ultimately though, it was found that it was going to be very expensive to both implement and certify a system like this, and given how rare the problem was, it was very hard to motivate that kind of expenditure. So what do I think about this then? Well, I think that as the data transfer technology via satellite becomes cheaper, better and more reliable, it's likely that we're going to see more and more of these data transfer systems taking place inside of our aircraft. In fact, a lot of airlines are already utilizing some data transfer via satellite in order to send messages ahead to their maintenance department in case they're coming in with, for example, a failure, so that the maintenance department's ready and they can minimize the on-ground delay. But when it comes to actually replacing the black boxes, I don't think that that's going to happen. I think that these type of systems are going to be there as a potential to supplement them, to make it easier and quicker for an investigation to start and take form. But the black boxes have something that is really important, and that is very high reliability until the very end of the flight. We need to know as much as we possibly can about what causes an accident all the way up until the very bitter end. And having an onboard system that records this is really the only and most reliable way that we can get this. And this is the point. We use the black boxes to learn as much as we can to stop stuff like that from happening. And because of that, it is unlikely that we're going to see any data transfer system replacing fully the old black boxes in the near or even far future. Now, I would love to hear your thoughts about this. Send them in the comments below. Check out this video next, which I think that you're really going to enjoy, or this playlist if you really want to binge some Mentor Now material. If you want to support the work that I do, as always, consider becoming part of my lovely Patreon family or get yourself some merch. Have an absolutely fantastic day, and I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.